Today's October 8th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. I just put some diatomaceous earth on his coat, so his fur looks a little like it's got some white powder and stuff on it. Did you drink some water? That diatomaceous earth is what I use to take care of the ticks and stuff like that. Instead of the front line, not only is it cheaper than front line, but it's not a pesticide, it's all natural. Good boy. Yeah. Let's see how he's dusty. And it's not the stuff you use in your pool, it's the food grade diatomaceous earth is what you use. It's a boy. Today is October 9th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. All the leaves are coming down. Looks really nice back here. Seems like the foliage is dropping about a week or two earlier than it did the past 3 years. Because I know the past 3 years, the colors were like at the peak around the ponds back here at like right on October 13th or October 12th. And now that happened like a week ago. So it's a couple weeks ahead. That could be another sign that it's going to be a bad winter. Guess we'll find out. There was a big blizzard in I think it was South Dakota, and there was like 25,000 cattle that were killed because of the early blizzard. They get a lot of blizzards in South Dakota, but just not just this early. That happened like a couple days ago. It's like the largest cattle kill off as a result of a blizzard that they can remember. Today is October 11th, 2013. It's exactly 1 year to the day since the last time that I took my last dog here for a walk on October 11th, 2012. The day that she got so tired she had to stop and lay down a couple times. And that was the last time that I took her for a walk, because the next day on October 12th she was just 2 weeks, and then October 13th, and 2 days from now, was it when she passed away around noon. She was walking really slow from the last time that I brought her back here. She's walking really slow. Like 4 times slower than she normally did. It's hard to believe that was a year ago. Today it seems like it was more like 6 or 7 months or something like that. It doesn't seem like it was a year. T- Tango's doing really good. We had some visitors come over today. Some old neighbors from when we used to live in Coventry many years ago. It's Pat Dione and Denise Dione, her daughter. Last day that I brought Brandy back here, she was walking so slow. Right about this area, she was right on my side, and I was filming her walking alongside me. And a little farther down in the stream is where she laid down for the first time back here because she was so exhausted. And then walking back, she laid down like three or four other spots. Take a rest, and then before she got over to the parking lot where I park, she didn't even make it to the car. She had to stop and rest again and took a couple pictures. And then when she got into my car, she didn't hop up into the back seat. She was too weak. She just sat there on the floor, so I had my front seat removed. When she basically stopped eating, she lasted 2 weeks basically. After she stopped eating, she ate a little bit here and there, and then after she went to the vet and they were force feeding her, she came home and I used that same thing to force feed her some more. So she did have some food, but she wasn't voluntarily eating for 2 weeks. She was walking real slow, my last dog, a year ago today. And she took her a while to actually go in there and drink some water. And she was moping around over in here, and then she came and she laid down right about there. Exactly 1 year ago. Good boy. Another nice spot. A little farther downstream. Didn't get a chance to bring my last dog here a year ago. She was too tired. I just walked back home from that last spot. Today's still October 11th, 2013. This is one of the spots where my dog lay down the last day I brought her back here. Still October 11th, well, right before you get back to that field. This was another one of the spots where Brandy lay down. Today's October 13th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. Today's the 1 year anniversary when my last dog passed away. It was on October 13, 2012. Right now it's about 5:45. The sun's gonna set in about 20 minutes, and this was right around the time that I buried her in the backyard. It was right before sunset, right around now, exactly 1 year ago. Went by pretty quick. She lived a long 15 years. She had a good life. You see something over there. Might be somebody else walking. Today's still October 13th, 2013. 1 year after Brandy passed away. This was like one of our favorite spots to stop and drink water. That's why I bring Tango over here all the time. Good boy. Tango reminds me a lot of my last dog, in a lot of ways. He's got a little bit more of a character than she did. There's a lot of people that walk back here with their dogs, and they have for many years, but I think when Brandy was alive, I think she was probably the dog that's been coming back here the longest. The town's only owned this for I think a little less than 10 years, or maybe right around 10 years, but I had been bringing Brandy back here even before the town owned it, so. She'd been coming back here all her life for 15 years. And I think out of all the dogs that come walking back here, I think she was the oldest, or the one that had been coming back here the longest. As far as people who walk back here, who have been coming back here the longest, I think I'm the one that's been coming back here the longest because I've been coming back here for like almost 30 years. The only other person that comes close is the Gernans that live across the street from the parking lot here. She said she's been coming back here for 20 years, but for me it's been almost 30. Good boy. Yeah? Still October 13th, the sun just set, so I don't know how well this video is going to come out. Usually my camera doesn't do too good when it gets this dark, but this was right around the time when I buried Brandy, right about now, and my dad lit like a fire in the backyard in the fire pit and burned a bunch of brush. I had a hard time sleeping for, I think it was like a couple months. It was over a month. I was only sleeping like a couple hours, and then I would wake up, and then I would go back to sleep. Sometimes I wouldn't even be able to sleep even more than a couple hours. I was like that for a couple months. Still think about her every day. Today is October 14th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. I got bit by my third tick today. I got bit about almost a week ago, and I went to the doctors and they put me on antibiotics for 3 weeks, and then it was like 2 days later I had another one bite me on like the side, like where my ribs are on the side, and 2 days later I got another one right in that same area, and then like 3 days later I got another one like on my arm. All these little ones, and they're real painful after I pull them out. Well, I'm still on the antibiotics, so I should be okay, but it's just a lot. I mean, I had a couple bites in the springtime, but I was able to get at them, like I noticed them right away and took them off right away. And then like through the whole summer, late spring, summer, early fall, didn't see any ticks at all. And now all of a sudden it's like wham, they're like, got three of them, and they're real painful kind. They bury their heads into you, and anyway, I think he sees something or hears something, but must be really bad. I guess probably because it's the deer getting close to the rutting season and they're starting to move all around, so now all the ticks are starting to come out and be all around more than they were in the summer, I guess. That's just what I'm thinking, but I don't know. It was a lot. All at once, I got three in the course of like a week. They were all the bad ones. So I guess now I'm going to have to start changing my clothing. Every day when I get home from taking this walk, I'm going to change my clothing, put my clothing out in the garage, check myself really well. And then put a sheet over my bed so Tango can lay on it, and then before I go to bed pull the sheet off in case there are any on him that came off. I want them to get on my bed. There was a couple of videos ago I mentioned about how there's different signs that are saying it could be a bad winter, and one of them was that recently there was a really bad blizzard in North Dakota or South Dakota. It's like one of the worst ones in recorded history, and it was like, I said there was like 25,000 heads of cattle that had died in the blizzard, but it was actually more than that. They're saying that it's like a couple hundred thousand cattle that had died, and some of them they're not gonna be able to find until springtime because the snow drifts are so deep. But it was like the most, it was the most devastating blizzard in terms of what the cattle ranchers experienced and their losses of heads of cattle. And it's a lot really early in the season for that a bad blizzard like that to be happening. There's that, and there's what the Farmer's Almanac says, and then there's the polar sea ice, how it's was 60% larger in August this year than it was August of last year. And the foliage ended up falling a little earlier than it has over like the past 3 years. The three seasons before this, around this pond here, the trees around the edge, you get to peak and they're the most colorful right around October 13th. But this year, it happened like a week and a half earlier. So there's that sign also. Hopefully it's not too bad of a winter. Still want to be able to come back here and walk and not have to use snowshoes all the time. And hopefully there's not a bunch of power outages for extended periods and extremely cold weather. I gotta get another block heater for my car. I want to put one on my transmission. I put one on my oil pan and it heats up the oil, because I use the real heavy duty oil in my car because it's so old. I want to get one for the transmission too, because I've got a little bit of thicker fluid in that transmission too. So if it gets really cold this winter, I'll just plug them in and leave them overnight so it stays warm. It's less wear on the engine than when I start it up. I ended up putting some diatomaceous earth on the back of Tango when I first got that tick bite, so I figured maybe he had some on him, and that agitated his skin and dried it out and caused him to start scratching and stuff again. So that bothered his skin, so then I gave him a bath, washed that off, and I've been giving him Benadryl. I give him one Benadryl every 4 or so hours or something like that. And that helps him out. But it looks like I'm not going to be able to use that diatomaceous earth anymore. I have to start buying the frontline chemical stuff, putting that stuff on him. He's got a vaccinated for Lyme disease, but that's not always a guarantee that he's not going to get Lyme disease or some other disease that ticks have, because they have a whole bunch of different diseases. It's not just Lyme disease. See, all the leaves are already all down around this pond. The past 3 years, they would have been just at peak color and they wouldn't have fallen yet. And they did that a couple weeks ago. Started to do some maintenance, preventative maintenance on my car before winter gets here. There are a couple rust spots and stuff around the wheel wells that I ended up taking the rust off and used some rust bullet stuff and a little bit of Bondo, and then I gotta paint it back over. I noticed there's a couple spots underneath the car that I gotta do also. I'm gonna do that pretty soon, maybe tomorrow. Get all that any rust spots taken care of before the winter gets here. And I noticed that my rear wheel bearings, the drums were a little bit loose, the bearings were a little bit, the lock nuts were a little bit loose, so I took the lock nuts off and I packed in some more grease in there and tightened down a little bit. They were a half a turn loose. But I gotta try to remember, in the springtime, should take them back off and pack some more grease in them again and see if they need to be tightened up a little bit. Because I put new bearings in them a couple years ago, I think. But I didn't bother to repack the bearings anytime recently. I gotta do that again in the spring. It's been a good car. I bought it 10 years ago, a little bit over 10 years ago, for $1,500. Pretty cheap, and it's never let me down and broke down, but I do preventative maintenance to it, where I look over things, and if something looks like it's getting old or something like that, then I'll replace it. I got a whole bunch of spare parts too, because I've got a couple other cars that are just like that, and a neighbor down the street that got into a wreck, and he's got a car just like that too, so I've got parts from three cars, a little bit more than three cars. The parts for them are actually really cheap, even compared to other cars, like a Chevy Cavalier, like the same year, or around the same years, or Honda Civics and stuff. The prices for my parts are actually cheaper, and it's because they still make my car in China. They're a little bit different. The bumpers and the headlights are updated, and I have airbags. Mine doesn't have airbags, but that's why the parts for mine are so cheap, because Volkswagen still makes them in China. So something that normally might cost like a brake disc or something for a car comparable to mine and the year comparable to mine might normally cost like $20 or $30, but for mine it costs $10. And it's because it's Volkswagen still makes those in China. There's a whole bunch of companies that make aftermarket replacement parts that are pretty inexpensive. So I was able to do a lot to it, like preventative wise. Change the radiator, that was only like, I think the radiator was like $50. All new hoses I put in there. I changed the belts every once in a while. Timing belt, water pump, heater core. What else is there? Like the axles I've changed and the bearings. I was able to do all that just for like a couple hundred dollars. So the car has really been worth it for 10 years and only spending $1,500 on to buy it. And a couple hundred bucks here and there replacing parts is pretty good. The insurance is really cheap too. It's only like, when I first got the car, it was only $100 for insurance for 6 months, but now it's gradually gone up every year. Now it's like $150 for 6 months. That's still not bad though. A lot of people pay a lot more for insurance than $150. Good boy. I might start talking more on these videos and use them as sort of like a journal for myself. But other things that's happened recently is I have a political Facebook page that has to do with like Ron Paul stuff, and I've got like 5,000 friends and like 10,000 followers or something like that. But I went to go on today and it said that somebody must have reported me or something to Facebook that doesn't like Ron Paul and stuff like that. And said that I need to change it from a normal page to like a cause or community page. Like a community action type cause kind of page. So I went through that process. And I get to the end though, to complete it, to have it converted over to that, and then an error comes up and says it was an error in converting your page. So, but I still have another fan page that was like an offshoot from that page. It has like 5,000 something followers, and but it'll be nice to get that page back up. If not, I'll probably just start another page and like put the word out through the other pages that I have, and so that people can know which page to add. And I don't really know if that's what happened, where somebody reported me, but I think that was because there were some people that were posting comments on some of the things I was posting, like, is this supposed to be a Ron Paul page? Cause some of the things I was posting like weren't about Ron Paul, it was just about like other current events, or like I would find something about some dog or something like that and I would post that. It's kind of just using it as like it was my page, which it is. I guess somebody didn't like that. just didn't like Ron Paul. And I was recently posting a lot of stuff about the government shutdown and things like that. And there was an Obama supporter that was commenting back and forth on some of the posts I was making. And she was trying to make it seem like, well, it wasn't Obama that made the decision to close the parks. That was like a standard operating procedure that they had come up with a long time ago. I said, where did you hear that? And she couldn't answer where she heard that from. I said, well, you're basically saying one of two things. You're saying that either Obama isn't in charge and he has no say in what gets closed and what gets open, or you're saying that he's not responsible and accountable for what gets, what people below him close and open. It's one or the other. And I was saying I don't really care that there aren't park rangers, because you don't need a park ranger to walk in the woods, or that there's a guide at some open-air war memorial, because that's not needed. They shouldn't just put up those gates. They should just not staff them. Even though the park rangers and those guides, Congress passed authorization to give them back pay anyway, so they're just on a paid vacation. They can just leave the open-air memorials open. They don't have to block them all off. And like, there was Mount Rushmore or some areas along where you can see Mount Rushmore from a distance, and they went off and put cones and blocked off the side of the road so people couldn't pull over to take pictures from a distance. And it shows you right there, they're doing it to try and make people think that, you know, like, oh, you need the government, otherwise you can't see the woods. You can't see these carvings, you can't see these memorials without the government, or without the federal government. And I don't think you need federal park rangers. You can have states that do that, volunteers that volunteer at the memorials to either pass out like maps or whatever that the guys normally do. You don't need paid federal employees to do that stuff. The states can do that because because the 10th Amendment to the Constitution states that anything that's not in the Constitution, it's left up to the states or to the people, respectively. So that means anything that isn't, if the federal government doesn't have authority to do something, it's the rights of the states or the people to do it. And there's nothing in the Constitution about federal park rangers and war memorial guides. So that means it's a state issue, or an issue for the people to volunteer and do. But a lot of people don't even know about the 10th Amendment, and they just think that the federal government should do everything. But centralized power always leads to problems. It's better to have more localized power. And you gotta imagine what would be better for making decisions. Would it be some bureaucrats hundreds or thousands of miles away that you've never met before, that's never been in your community? Do you think they'd be able to make better decisions for you? Or do you think more local decisions of people that live in your own town, your own community, if they'd be able to make the better decisions? That's why I said localized decisions are better than national, large scale decisions for everybody. It's better to have regional, local decisions. And that's how the Constitution was framed. That's why the 10th Amendment's there. Constitution's a rule book for the government, federal government. Anything that they don't cover, it's not something you just make up. It means that it's left up to the states. Why the 10th Amendment's there. Oh, my battery's getting low. I'm gonna shut it off for today.
Woof! Woof!
Who's that?
don't bite them.
Who's that?
Woof. Woof. Woof.
Go bite them. Go bite them. Go get them. Go. Yeah.
Hey, now that I'm filming them.
Woof.
Good boy. Who's that?
Get him.
Good boy. Yeah. You're okay. Today's October 18th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. There was a lady that was walking by today when I was outside in the garage cleaning those rust spots off of my car from underneath. She had her young child in the back of one of the Red Ryder wagons. And Tango was looking at her as they were walking by. I just wanted to make sure that he wasn't gonna like run out towards them and start barking at them and scare them. But he didn't. Usually he only barks if somebody like actually comes into the yard. But if they're walking by, he won't bark and stuff. And that's good. Because I think that lady with her child would have been scared. But then he walked, after they walked by, he walked towards the end of the driveway and was like smelling in the air to get their air scent to see if he recognized them. Well, I took care of those couple rust spots under my car. Hopefully I won't have to do that again and like do them over and put more of that rust bullet paint on them for a couple more years. But that rust bullet paint's been working really good. If it wasn't for that stuff, I would have had a lot more rust on that car. That paint works really good. It's like aluminum paint or something. It's really a tough paint and doesn't kind of like protects the metal from rusting anymore. Even if you don't remove all the rust and you just paint right over it, it does really good. This whole area here before you get to the ponds, it's mostly maples going all through there and going all the way back, and they lose all their leaves like right in the beginning. But I found a spot in the stream that leads to the ponds over here, some clay deposits, and I harvested some clay so I could try to make some like primitive bowls and crafts and things like that from the clay. And I noticed when I was processing the clay and sifting out like the different other particles that get in it that you don't want in it, I found there was a bunch of the maple tree, the pinwheel kind of seeds. So this whole area here must have had maple trees for a long time, because those clay deposits were old. They were farther down. So it must have been like hundreds of years ago. There were still a whole bunch of maple trees back in, going from here straight back by like a couple hundred yards that way. Mostly maple trees. see all the barberries are ripe. These are edible. They don't really taste great. They're okay. You can make a jam out of them because they have enough pectin in them. And they're supposedly good for helping to like thicken up your blood before winter. The root of those barberries are, there's no berries on this, but that's the barberry. It's a really good natural antibiotic. It's got the same chemical that golden thread and golden seal have. It's called berberine. It's like one of the best natural antibiotics. Here's some more, but that's in the roots. I mean, it's found in the whole plant, but it's mostly in the roots. Here's some more berries. Well, I don't know when exactly Tango's birthday is. I'm guessing he's right around 6 years old now. So hopefully he'll live a nice long life like my last dog did. Won't be in a like stressful environment. I'll have a stress-free environment and always have company. And won't have to be eating food that he's allergic to, because I'm sure that's not going to be good for him over a period of time. So he'll have good food, good environment, exercise. He is larger though, so usually larger dogs don't live as long. But you never know, he could live over 12 years old. That'd be nice. My last two dogs lived at 15. I had a German Shepherd last time. She lived at 15, then I had another German Shepherd before that. That was crossed with a Beagle. She lived at 15 too. I kind of miss cooking chicken and rice like I used to for my last dog. But it's a lot more convenient just doing it with the bagged dry dog food, but I don't know, it's the fish and potato mix, and it says it's white fish, which is basically just like whatever kind of cheap fish they can get. And with that Fukushima power plant in Japan after that earthquake releasing all that radiation into the Pacific, there's already been a lot of radiation found in fish. Like all the tuna fish they're finding off the coast of California, they're finding it all contaminated with some level of radiation. The EPA raised the safe level, so by old standards it wasn't safe, but because they rigged the numbers and now supposedly more radiation is safe now. They're saying it's still safe levels, but and it's been shown up in some other fish too, harvested in parts of Alaska in the ocean. So I'm just hoping that that fish and potato food that I'm feeding him, that fish that's in there, isn't like radiation contaminated from the Fukushima power plant. So I'm considering maybe switching him to, it's the same kind, it's a grain free, same company, but it's not the fish and potato brand. It's like they've got a beef and potato, and I'm thinking about trying that one instead. That way there won't be any risk of him getting that radiation, but then he's not gonna have the fish oils, so I'll have to start giving him fish oil again. The tablets, but that's not a big deal. I think maybe I should try that. Switch it to the beef and potato. Today's October 19th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. I caught him last night. I usually try to keep doing the same things with him at the same times, because dogs like routines. They don't like changes and things like that. It causes a little stress for them. So, and he's gotten into his own routines that he likes to do also. Like, for one is, when I end up going to bed, he wants to go outside. Like, I'll lay down, and then he'll come over and he'll want to go out for a little while. And it's like the longest time he'll spend outside is like right before I go to bed. And last night he was outside for quite a while, for like 20 or 30 minutes or something. And I looked out the window, the moon was shining. And it was actually a lunar eclipse yesterday. But the moon was shining, it was after the eclipse. And I saw him just sitting, laying down in the backyard. So I left him alone and came back and looked. And then I noticed he was over in the garden. And I'm like, well, what's he doing inside the garden? It was already all like cleared out and stuff. There wasn't anything growing in there. And I noticed he was like putting his head down near the ground, like he was digging up something, or I don't know what it was. And then he comes back out of the garden, and then he like lays down like he's like eating something. And my dad just went fishing and he buried a bunch of guts in the garden. I didn't know if he like dug up the fish guts and was eating them or whatever. But later in the morning I went and looked, and I don't know what it was he was eating. It could have just been some of the leaf mulch and stuff that my dad put on the spread out on the garden. It was just something in that leaf mulch that he picked out and was messing with or something. I don't know, maybe he wasn't, but it looked like he was. I mean, I know he was in the garden and he was like messing around with something. I don't know if he actually ate it or not, but you know, it was kind of strange. But he's gotten into a habit of doing that. Not so much going in the garden. I don't know if he's got a habit of going in the garden, but he's got a definite habit where at nighttime he wants to go out. Like when I go and lay down, I want to go out and spend like 20 or 30 minutes outside. Today is October 20th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. I ended up having to leave yesterday for a couple hours, and today for about an hour, and he's been doing really good when I leave. He doesn't keep whining a lot like he used to when I used to leave. He gets really well along, gets along really well with my parents. They seem to like him. Boy, he's been scratching his right ear quite a bit, like the past couple days, and last night I put some of that like ear solution that the vet gave me just to like clean out the ears, and if there's like any infection and stuff like that, I put that in there. And he's still shaking a little bit, so if it doesn't go away like tomorrow, I might do it again. And if it doesn't go away, he's got a vet appointment soon. So, if it doesn't go away and I try it again, I'll probably schedule a vet appointment for in a couple more days and they can check it out. But, he seems okay. Yeah, good boy. Tango and I just spooked a deer coming on this trail next to where the old trolley track used to be. Coming up to the top, and all of a sudden we heard like thump, thump, thump on the ground. And we couldn't see, there's some lower pine trees over there, but we couldn't see. I'm pretty sure it was a deer like thumping really loud and running away as we spooked it. And then we heard another one over here. There's a lot of them around here. I've seen a lot of them around here. See, he's looking around. There's a lot of them around here. This one area.
Climb on top of you, Tango.
You gotta get some more exercise. Come on, Tango.
Somebody pull us down.
That came down in the storm. That came down in the storm. Don't pull it back out. Don't pull it back out. Now push it back in. It's going to get in the way of people leaving. That came down in the storm. Come here, Tango. I said it came down in the storm. Somebody didn't pull it down. It came down in a storm. You don't need to pull it out. Why don't we just walk? You can do that later. Today is October 24th, 2013. Tango's doing really good. I ended up picking up Mr. Carlson down the street. Or not picking up, I went down there to see if he wanted to go for a walk because he hasn't come back here in like 8 months or something like that. And he had that car accident last year. So he's not as strong as he used to be. He's been wheezing on the way back here. He's having a hard time keeping up and he has to keep stopping, so I'm going to try to make a habit out of going and getting him and see if he wants to go for a walk. You want to say hi? You're on a candid camera? Molly, you're on candid camera.
Yeah.
Today is October 29th, 2013. We're at the Big Rock spot. I'm taking a go swimming again. My battery's getting low. The big rock spot. Just took Mr. Carlson for a walk. I wanted to come down here and test something out. Tango's doing good.